All right, so I know everyone definitely should be able to hear me now, and I just want to say wholeness and balanced vibration to everyone. Of course, it's an amazing day. Today is my birthday, and I felt like just giving the gifts of all gifts, which is anything that's given to me, I would give to you. And of course, that is, of course, my time and my energy. And today is generally a day that people demark and they want it to be exclusively for themselves. But I want to send a trend out for individuals who are going to be going into their birthdays or having birthdays to spend that time and spend that joy with others and let them know how important they are by showing that you even consider them when it's supposed to be an important day for you. So today, of course, and I want to say thank you, first of all, to everyone who's wished me happy birthday. Thanks a lot. I mean, it means a lot. I've just gotten an overwhelming response, and of course, it's still early in the morning here in Costa Rica. Today, of course, is a continuation of yesterday's show. We had this major technical meltdown, which we haven't actually had in a long time. And I really saw that definitely by the end of the evening as a sign that this show and this information and what's to be given to individuals is to be done live, in that I would be here to explain it to you face to face, and that way you can get your quickening and you can move on to the rest of your existence here in the universe and innerverse. So to get right into this, again, I think I just have to go over a couple things, because I really want to make this conversation to a level where if it's the individual's first time looking at any other work of the resistance and the Wholeness Foundation, this can give them not only an introduction of what we're doing, but also a continuation of how we continuously have at every point come into higher levels of knowledge and inspiration for humanity. And that means a lot to me, because if we're to get the support of everyone, basically, in the reality that we can, then they need to see why we do what we do and why we believe what we believe. So that's going to be a major part of today's show. Before I get started, actually, I've already got a confirmation that the sound is great. So let's go ahead and get right into this. I just want to say, first and foremost, again, my name is James Evans Bomar III. I am the developer of the Resistance website and the author of the book, The Code to the Matrix. And really how this began for me, well, it's always been going on. There's really not a time in which it began. It's important for everyone to know that we're eternal beings. We're forever we're awake or asleep or in between at times, and this creates this perpetual being that we are. But to just understand a little bit of my background, you have to understand that I've gone through every single religious belief system as a child to later on in life be able to connect those systems. And so I begin that by saying that my mother raised us in Wahhab Islam, which is a very strict sect of Islam where you abide by all the laws, all the rules, all the doctrines. And she chose to move away from that into Christianity or Gnosticism, but she didn't do it in a haphazard way of just joining up with any church. She went to every single church in order to see every single, what you would call, denomination of church, which is, of course, Presbyterian, Pentecostal, Baptist, Holiness, all of these different churches, AMB. She went to these churches to see what the different variations were and why Christianity and being one religion had so many different sects. So after that major quest for all of us, because I was with her during that adventure, we came to the conclusion of Gnosticism, meaning that you have the ability to know what's going on without being told. And I feel like that's very important. Let's adjust myself here. And I feel like that's important, and the reason is because when you're younger, you have this connection and contact with the individual they later on give the name of God to. But it's not a name to you. It's a special essence and a special feeling of something that you connect with that you feel is magical, and you feel that it's expansive and beyond, and it can offer every single one of your grand desires and grand projections, your imagination, in a sense. So what happens later on in life, though, because we have to remember that is the original pure essence of what we now know as a deity or a god or a messiah or a savior or whatever. Because later on in life, what you'll see is individuals start tagging God or tagging the high levels of energies and saying, those belong to me. And thus, the individuals who want to follow that or believe in that end up getting rolled into what is now known today as a religion. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through the expanse of history and her story. I like to put that in there. And see what exactly is manifested over this lifetime that we've lived in and that we can also account for with our ancestors. See exactly where we are now, so that way we can definitely know where we're going to go. And really, really give it the best shot that we can, not as scholars, not as individuals who are well-known and well-studied in Cambridge and Harvard, but just as individuals who are endowed with reason, which is the ability that we do have over what we would call the animal. Like, an animal is not thinking, well, what am I going to wear today? Animal has fur. So the reality is that even the way we think and the way we reason, when we decide that we want to wear red, or we want to wear black, or we want to wear gray, or whenever we decide that we want to do something, that is called reason. So now we must think, who endowed us, or where did we acquire reason? Because that is what separates us from the next genus of beings, which of course is the animal kingdom, which we're very close to still. People are so close to their dogs, they're so close to their birds or their cats, that it's a member of the family. And this is for a reason. There's a reason why we're all here on this planet together. And our EverQuest, or what we call the astral quest, is for us to enjoy that, to experience that, and to know what that is. So first off, I do want to say, though, as a disclaimer, that just as a man can never explain to you the labors of childbirth, and this is important to think about, a man can never explain to you the labors of physical childbirth because he does not have a womb. So, in that sense, there are things that many of us go through in life that we wouldn't be able to explain to another person unless we went through it ourselves. Likewise, there are things so potent in this reality, such as spirituality, that if a person hasn't really had a spiritual experience, but they want to step up and start speaking on spirituality, it's going to be very difficult for the individuals that are listening to that individual, because they're not basing what they know upon any real experience. And this, of course, is the difference now in our reality, because many people choose to just read about something and to not experience it themselves to see if it's true. And then actually base their entire decision-making system on something they may have read. And this, of course, is what they call the clipple of Hermes, who taught man how to write, but that man and woman how to write, according to the mythology. However, that also bred us in a way where our memories were not going to be as important anymore. We could just write things down. And if you think about it, there are people still that have actually memorized the entire Quran, verse by verse. And I'll just use that book because it's more well-known. There are people who know the entire Quran. So imagine the memory of our ancestors, and then see how that memory has decayed because we've chose to use external devices, whether it's writing was our first system. Now, of course, we're on computers, but we're using external devices to store our memory. And that's, of course, why in a computer it's called the memory. So just remember, the ancestors had this huge memory. There was no real need for writing things down, and that's why before a certain point, the most that you'll get is a particular symbol. You won't get an entire essay and thesis on it. So what we have to really uncover here is first, now I actually have notes here. Everyone loves my notes because then I actually can stay cohesive somewhat. And today indeed is going to be cohesive because I even got a chance to upload all of the pictures that are supposed to be in the show. And for those who have been watching the show in beta, it's been like pulling teeth with some of the images that are supposed to be uploaded and where they are, etc. But today we actually got them all uploaded, so let me go ahead and open that folder. Of course, this is the live stream interactive show. We want to thank live stream for that. And here we go. Let's get it started. I just want to first show you that with symbolism, you have to realize, and by the way, let me turn this camera on. Ooh, I almost forgot. Get that thing on HD copy. We will have an HD copy available for everyone here after the show or after it gets processed, but I want to make sure we get this camera on because we need at least two or three backups today for this conversation, because yesterday I also could feel that the conversation was so potent, it was blowing out live stream and Blog Talk Radio at the same time. And, you know, we had a major, like I said, technical meltdown, but it was obviously, again, because I was supposed to be here in person with you today talking about this. And the other backup to that is you have to have some type of digital or professional recording. So just in case someone doesn't catch something, there's something available for them later to catch it. So I'm going to start now by publishing a picture of pyrite. And you'll see that come up there, along with a picture of a water crystal. Because we're going to go on a fantastic adventure through the Innerverse today, and it's just going to blow your mind. It's blown my mind, imploded my mind, and now I'm here with that expansion. On my 34th birthday, by the way, I just happened to come into the rest of the information about this particular level of the leveling up process that I'm going through personally in my life through spirituality. And so I want to start off by explaining to people that here's what you see nature producing, which is actually a pentagram or a pentagon and a hexagon. Okay? So before we even get into this knowledge about who symbol it belongs to and who really has the power and who's, you are that being in many sense, but if you really want to understand where it's coming from, you need to look at the organic nature of this reality in the creators of that. Because these are the tools that they're choosing to use as the building blocks to create everything. Of course, this pentagon and hexagon stretches far out into nature into different variations. So I just want it to be clear now before we start getting into pantheism and polytheism and monotheisms and all the theisms, how this knowledge belongs to an entirely different superstructure of knowledge that is far more expansive than the limitation of the gods and the rest of the individuals that say, I did it, I created, I did this and that. Okay, so let that be clear. Very beautiful water crystal, by the way. I was looking at it and they said, yeah, because water is life. You got to realize that everything can be made out of water. Like it's a base molecule, it's a base fuel. And those who understand how to maneuver it and to manipulate it, as they say, water has 40,000 memory panels in each cell. Those who know how to utilize the water are indeed some of the most powerful individuals on the planetary system or in the universe. You could speak intention to water and then drink it. You can store dreams in water by laying on dreaming next to a glass of water and then drinking that and then recalling the dream. There's such a major connection with water. But I did, again, want it to be known to everyone that these symbols, before being used by other belief systems and social structures, etc., do belong to nature and are infinite with their abilities, meaning that all of what these symbols can be used for hasn't even been truly delved into at all. So we begin first Indus, in the Indus Valley, because the Indus Valley was the place that there was a migration from first. Actually, before I get into this Indus Valley, I do want to introduce a couple more symbols here, excuse me, just so that in the beginning of our conversation, you can clearly see that the symbols have more of a meaning with nature and that the indigenous people were using these symbols for a very long time before many individuals, whether it be the neo-Nazi party, whether it be the United States of America, whether it be the United Nations, before any of them started using the symbols that they're brandishing as their own. Now, here again is an ancient Indus Valley swastika. The Indus Valley is the place that is right between Egypt and Angkor Wat. So either you go this way to Egypt or you go that way to Angkor Wat. But both temples are conscribed to Orion. If you understand the Egyptian pyramids in Lower Egypt, then you understand the temples in Angkor Wat are all lined up to the constellation of Orion. So you see here that the swastika being used in the Indus Valley in ancient times, and these were unearthed from the Indus Valley archaeological digs. So this is, again, oops, here I gotta make sure I know, watch out what I'm doing here. And this is, again, a clear sign to you that the symbols that are being used belong to really ancient indigenous people. And so if we don't get the full understanding of it from them, in a sense, then we definitely shouldn't be getting the understanding of it from someone who supposedly graduated in religion at, you know, UCLA or something, because after it got to them, it was already hacked. We'll just use that term. Here we go again, the footprint of Buddha also containing swastikas. And of course, these footprints have been unearthed in many places before any regimes had ever even been thought of. Like, these are some of the ancient things that were inscribed on cave walls, etc. And again, in the beginning, I just need to source these images so that you have a foundation. Because when we start taking this ship off, some people are going to want to jump on different sides. Like, remember, while I'm explaining the ping pong game between really brothers and sisters fighting each other, somebody's going to want to jump on one side. I'm with Canaanites, or I'm with Asuras and the Nagas, and I'm with, you see, this is where you'll make a mistake, just like so many. Earth is interesting because it judges you based on who you are. That's just how it works. So you're shown many things in the reality that you may be able to take advantage of or you may be able to have, but you always have to think about it completely. You have to have your reason and the responsibility to understand what you're going to manifest if you pick up any type of manifestation tool. This is the same thing that the ancient ancestors and the higher beings, et cetera, whatever you want to call them, are trying to teach us, which is about our responsibilities. The major responsibility on this planet is with our seeds, which is, of course, our children. So if you see the state of the children right now, you can obviously see that we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing. And also that we better start doing it, or else all of the other stuff that is impending behind not doing it will probably be subject to happen, but could be prevented if we just start doing what we're supposed to be doing. That's what an adult is. When you do what you're supposed to do, then you actually see the results and the benefits of it go in one direction. It's how you guide the ship, which is you. So let's get started here. So I've already sourced to you several images showing you not only swastikas, not only Ankhs, not only what's called now the Star of David, which is the Shere Khan Dravidian star. I've shown you many of these images being used as the cross way before it was related to Jesus and Solar Invictus. I showed you all of these emblems, and even the fleur-de-lis or the trifold trimurti energy before it was in the hands of the Queen of England. So let us begin. I will tell you first that those who speak the Devangari, which is the language of the gods, and those who are of the Tanaim, who are those who know what angels know, can bear witness to what I am explaining to you today. Here you will find ancient Tamil, which is a matriarchal language, probably the oldest language here in our world. And these languages were known to be like water or like fire because of the way water and fire moves. They both have that curvature licking type thing they do, right? Because water and fire are exact opposites, making them really the same. This symbol became known as either a red triangle inside of a blue triangle, which we get today as called a hexagram. Fire and water. So maybe even water itself, or actually not maybe, but water itself is a byproduct of something. That something that you cannot see until it's condensed. That something is more like a mist. And this is where we get the term mystical. So this something is like a vapor, and then what the water is it's the vapor gathered. So to understand the mist has to be created from the unity of fire and water. Okay? So this is the deeper knowledge where you can actually put yourself on the right track immediately is by seeing that fire and water are actually the same. And when you can do that, then what you have done is you've joined these two elements. Now you're a generator. This is what the sun has accomplished. This is what the absolute has accomplished, to become a generator, to merge the positive and negative forces, quote unquote, together and getting them working in harmony to create a dynamo. That is the ancient teaching, summed up. So what happens, though, is that in the battlefield, that sometimes they call the battlefield of Varunja, which is the battlefield of the mind, our entire existence has been with us wrestling with between the both sides of our energy and choosing one side over the other when we should have already learned the knowledge of how to merge those energies together. So the second image, or the next image that I'm going to show you here, is the Naga, because that gets us on our journey. Now, it has been a misconception that the Naga are actually serpent beings that live here on Earth. It is misconception that Naga are only black people. Okay? Because black people love to jump on the side of the Naga. I have to explain to humanity what Naga really is, because it's not actually a being at all. It's an energy. And what I mean by that, it's not a physical being. And I'm going to show you several ancient pictures, or at least three here, to make sure that that is very clear to you, that what Naga really is means earth. Okay? Naga means earth. It doesn't mean a human being walking around earth. The human beings, the ones that called them Naga, really said that they were children of Naga, or children of the earth. Okay? Now, here's the image of the Naga, which is rich with symbolism. The only thing you need to see here first is that the Naga has wings and has a snake body. This means it has mastered the low level, which a snake crawls on, he bites the dust, and the high level, which is the bird. These are the difference between electric and the magnetic energies. Okay? So that is in the symbolism. The next thing in symbolism is what's in the hand, which is here, is the conch shell. The conch shell is the knowledge of Phi. That's why you can see the spiral here. Phi, of course, later on became known as the pentagram. Phi, fire, the pyramids or the pyramids, fire in the middle. The knowledge of Phi is encoded within the seashell. The knowledge of Phi is encoded within the pine cone. The reason why it's encoded in here is because nature is building in these structures. So what the Naga is saying that it's offering here is the knowledge of how to build worlds. Okay? Now begins the era where there is an agenda by the Naga, which is obviously super sentient, connected with other planets and other things in this system, decide that they want to speed up the indigenous man's life by introducing him to how to create life and how to build life. Okay? You see what happens next. So as this is being offered, and let's get to another image here. And now let me prove to you that the Naga is not a person per se. If you want to get to the origins of it, it's already the extraterrestrial in itself. It's actually the all of the planets. That's what the Naga really is. Because each serpent actually stands for a planet. And again, the ancients had expansive memories, so they didn't have time to really write essays for you about this. Everyone knew it already. There was nothing to write. So what you see here is a picture that is an ancient picture. There's different variations of that, very old. But there's only one thing, because many people have seen this before from other shows that I've done. But the main thing I want you to focus on is that you have two different sides, i.e. the positive forces and the negative forces. Okay? And they are pulling on a rope. Right? You think that's a rope if you're not paying close attention. But if you look all the way to the left, you see the rope has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 heads on it. Meaning it's a Naga, and those heads look like snakes. So what these type of images are basically the tracing boards, as they have now the Masonic tracing board. This is the indigenous tracing board of the original levels of power that were coming to this planet. You see on the left side the bow, the crescent moon, the horse, the calf. You see on the right side the symbols of the elephant. You see the conch shell. You see many of the things that, if you understood their meaning in not only nature but also in our life, then you would see, oh my goodness, they were already onto it right then. They had all the symbolism there. You see down in the bottom the turtle, which of course has the hexagon on its back. So the symbolism is replete. But notice how the Naga is actually being used to tow the forces, or to as the tool to govern the force between good and evil, okay? So this is now why you have to understand that the serpent itself, which is the Naga, became symbol. It was the symbol of a certain level of power. which is encoded within the ley lines of our planet, which is encoded in the word Levi, which is an anagram for the word evil, or and live, and which is the root to the word Leviathan, which or the great serpent, meaning that the serpent energies that move in course through this planet, those who know how to use those forces had, as we will see, begin to war with each other using those forces. So this is why the forces became known as destructive. The forces were known to be tied into individuals that had done dark, crazy things. But likewise, that the forces have been termed as being the final attainment of this planet, how to supersede all illusions of this planet, and how to truly show one's great worth. Meaning, if you say that you're here to help and save everyone, these are the type of energies that were associated with that. So that's why the forces, now of course it's a lot easier to use the power for negative reasons. Just as it's easier to walk down a hill than up a hill. So what happens is that we see that the symbolism in the ancient knowledge was already there. And if we had just paid attention to that, then we would have understood the meaning of anything and everything. Now we're at a point where nothing really makes sense. So it's most important now for us to, especially for me, to show you the exact procession of the knowledge. So let's go to what's next here. Okay. So now everyone is in the Indus Valley, smack dab in between Egypt and Angkor Wat. The knowledge of the Naga, or the earth, and its representatives begin to fuse themselves with the indigenous people. This creates what I believe is a human being with chakras. Because chakras are wheels of time, it makes perfect sense to me that the indigenous people of this planet that were indigenous had probably one wheel. The beings that came to them, because of the level of knowledge and power that they had, the essence of whatever the planet actually really is, can give more of these powers. And like, this is what you see in mystical lore, that God can give you power. He can give you higher senses. This is what they say. Angels can give you power. They can give you different senses. They can do different things for you. Notice how there's a reoccurring story here. So it's obviously what the Naga had to offer also with this knowledge, or the people of the Naga, were how to turn on this system. But of course, at this time, what has already occurred is there's been an imbalance. And this is what the light side and the dark sides consist of. Even though you should know now, they're all coming from the same energy or same entity, as if it's running us through a test. Meaning that if the earth has given this power to see what you're going to do with it, then it's basically testing you with all of the power, all these powers. But it doesn't mean that it cannot and will not put you in check and put you under control at some point in time. Actually, humanity finds itself in a position where it's being governed now, meaning that all these powers and abilities that I'm going to have to explain to you today are foreign to you because you have been deactivated, benched. So what this is also about, this is about ascension, awakening, getting you off the bench and actually into actuality. Now here I'll show you some statues that were pulled of Dravidian teachers. Now, these are later on what became known as Naga, meaning that whatever the Naga, the original being, was an idolization of these ancient people. They saw it as seven heads of snake power, seven chakras. They, when saying what was the first one to come, don't say it was human at all. They just say that it infused them or tanned them. Okay, so if you pull this apart, you'll find out, of course, tan is the other word for serpent, but it's also the word for meaning taking in the energy, which is a lot of the Eastern teachings. And people, when they lay in the sun, they tan, of course. So what happens is that these individuals, and that's probably why they were so dark, were always tanning with these essences and energies from these planetary systems. Whether that was through crystals, stones, frequencies, tones, vibrations, etc., I believe that's really where the knowledge came in at, because you could really find it everywhere. So even some people say there were some of these conch shells that blew tones that would just do amazing things with energy. So now what I'm trying to get you to understand is that the Naga is one thing, more probably like the serpent and Leviathan energy of the entire planet that coils. It's more of an electrical pranic energy, okay? Versus the children of the Naga, which actually are more than just the melanin dominant man that is in Africa, but also the melanin recessive man that is in the Caucasus, and the Druid that is bringing up these fire energies. And actually, they need more the fire energy than someone in the tropical place. So you have to understand that this power is what has been the test here and was given to all races and all walks at one time, which is basically our ancestors. And this is what happens. You know, we need to learn from their lessons. Knowledge is passed. Getting you another picture here, just so you can see just how fantastic things are as far as building is concerned with these individuals, so you can get a state of mind that they're in. Here is a temple located in the Indus Valley, a Tamil temple, okay? Now, of course, since this is interactive, you can see the picture for yourself, and you can see just how extensive these temples really are. And the level of mind state, because they're all symmetric, the mind state that the people are working with. So you can stop believing that these were just indigenous coming from the word indigent, meaning needy. That's not what was going on. These people were fully tapped in. So now we get a chance to see that maybe we weren't just the only ones who knew how to reason very well. So you have empires being started up by the Dravidians, and this is the beginning now. This is what gives you Korea. This is what gives you China. This is what gives you India. This is what gives you the Amaraka, which means immortal serpent, America. This is what gives you all of these places. Because what's actually happening here is that in the what's called the cradle of civilization, Kush, is in there, like you're in there like a cushion. Then there's a spreading from there of individuals who actually have the energy within them. It's already activated. Okay? And these become the empires. Now, the reason why it has to be a splitting is something has to occur. I'll show you in mathematics later on what occurs, but if you just ask yourself, well, why did everyone leave? Weren't we happy there? There was conflict, because this is what powering energy does. If you don't know how to control it and you're just a child, you go into extreme conflict with it. So this is the process. They went into extreme conflict and could no longer be around each other. This is encoded within and changed up and swapped all out in the Old Testament as the sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, beginning to argue with one another and fight with one another, having so much energy and power they can smote one another. And this is the war between Cain and Abel, which is really the war between the Aryans and the Asuras. This is the ancient knowledge that has already been written, and you can still go and get on the internet today. Thank goodness we got internet to go and check the truth. But if you don't realize that this is what happens, and you find yourself as a product of a reality that has you on a battlefield like a toy soldier, playing emotional games with you. So if you keep watching, you'll see how things have metamorphosized and have changed your beliefs. So now the Dravidians have now set up these empires, but they split up. As I said, the heads of the dragon come off. And this is why India shows the dragon, China shows the dragon, the people in Egypt show Apophis. They show you the snake relation as an ancestor, because they're saying originally Naga. The Naga energy flowing through the earth. It's unlimited. It can make snakes and birds and elephants and grass and trees. You see what I mean? So whatever the Earth's energy is doing, notice this, it can make everything. It's not just limited to making one thing. So if you've gone to believe that maybe the ego is the greatest, you've missed it again. So I'm showing you here the temple that was in Angkor Wat, just so you have that as a reference. And now remember, this society is matriarch, and this is why. Now, first of all, matriarch can really be seen more as androgynous in this time. And the reason is because the man comes forth from the woman's womb. That's why he's called man, and it begins with ma. So in a matriarch, the reason why everyone is under the one accord that we all come from the same thing is because they all saw themselves coming out from the inner womb of this earth, which became later on known as the center of the earth, Hyperborea, the center of the earth beings, and the Aryans got involved saying there was new age movements going on in the center of the earth, etc. You see them corrupt the knowledge, but the knowledge is the ones who originally here first came from within the earth, because the earth itself is a womb, it's a matrix. Incubation, the core of earth is where the seed is, and then so the first ones that came up from the center, then out of the actual vesica of the earth. Okay, so what you see here is that the matriarch society was already in understanding of where the energy was coming from, and it was seen more as androgynous. But so what you have here is you have the temples of Angkor Wat and the temples also of Egypt aligned to the Orion constellation, but you also see the imagery, which I don't happen to have here with me, but I can source later on. But if anyone's seen any Angkor Wat documentaries, you'll see that there is many drawings, paintings, and sculptures of a feminine being. Later on, defaced as yoni worship. So understand it's matriarch, but matriarch is more of a state of mind of understanding everything came from one thing. There's nothing separate. And this is what you have to understand very clearly. This is the deeper knowledge behind all of the secrets of the secrets, is that the universe is in this cycle of constantly being asleep and awake, asleep and awake, and everything in between, and it's immortal. You have a choice to stay in that cycle of being asleep and awake, or go completely asleep, or be completely awake. Okay? You choose. But what happens is because the first primordial nature of this planet, which was all is self, everything is together, we're all connected, that is known as universal non-identity. Non-conformity, meaning needing no rules, globulous, dark matter, unconscious, harmonic, meaning that you're not trying to be harmonic. Like people say, I just need to get in harmony. Harmony is not something you try to do. It's something that you are. You see what I mean? So, but because of that state, how that interprets to us in the physical reality in 3D becomes sometimes like an anarchy, going against everything, no rules, no conformity. So there's a constant urging for humanity to go, for a part of humanity to go in that direction. This is why you see people glorify death here on this planet and naturally do things that are the wrong things, even though the right choice is in front and they choose wrong. You see what I mean? So that inclination is actually a yearning to return to unconscious primordial goo, which is actually the dark matter fields in which life is brought forth from. So if you want to venture out further into existence, that's what we're talking about today. All those who want to choose to go back in dust, then by all means, if that's what you feel is your path, then go your way. And those people, again, will make up the foundation of what some of those who have breached higher limits are standing on. So everything still has a purpose. So I just had to explain that again so you understand towards the end of this conversation, why is there this fascination with going in the wrong direction? It's really an actual yearning for the darkness of the womb, like a yearning for a mother rather than the venturing and understanding that mother is always there. Mother and father are always there. You are them. You see? So this is also the difference between, you see how when a child feels confident, a child will run out. When the child is scared, the child will go nowhere and will cling to the parent. This is where you get the psychology nature of what's going on, but it has more of a spiritual essence to it. It's entirely spiritual. So let us now watch the knowledge start taking some transformation in the first being who gets their name tied into the transformation and how it's taking place is Brahma. Because the Brahmic tradition is the oldest tradition. This is what the first metamorphosis from the matriarch was. And I'm waiting here for my screen to change here, but the first procession from the matriarch was through Brahma. Now, if you notice, in most images of Brahma, you see Brahma with three faces. One on the left, one in front, and one on the right. However, the image of Brahma is supposed to be shown also with a face in the back, which is known as Saraswati. Because Brahma is actually an androgen. And this is important even though for those who don't know, understand Brahmanism and really some that may not even care. But it is important because it is your history. So what happens here is that if you notice Brahma being depicted here with three faces, but there is a face that is known to be in the back or where he cut himself. This is, of course, now in Genesis as that God took from the rib of man and made one. Okay, whatever. What was going on in their concept, they said that the back of Brahma, which was 108 parts in the front, 108 parts in the back, 216, 6 times 6 times 6, 216, the name of the physical body, or the name of man, which man means more than woman, especially since masculine has man, ma in front of it again. What we see is that Brahma had his correspondent that started to become lost, meaning that people started not to recognize the womb and the matriarch of the planet anymore. There's a pulling away from the womb. They don't take the womb with them, like what you'll have to do in hyperspace and astral space and wherever you're going. You'll have to always carry the anchors with you, the time, the proper tools to navigate realities, etc. What happens here is that now what starts to come forth from the East is the teaching of Brahmanism. Brahma is now split into three components, meaning the idea of who the totality is now split into three components. This becomes Trimurti. It becomes one of the first religions ever practiced here on earth that later on becomes Zoroastrianism, later on become Mithraism, later on become Christianity, etc. So it's very important for individuals to see that. Now look at in one of the, on the left side of Brahma, if you're looking at the screen, you'll see the conch shell in the hand. Meaning that they're still attempting to associate with the individual who first brought this knowledge to them. There's still a connection there. So understand, the connection was still identified between Brahma and the ancient energies. Move forward a little bit. Here's another image here. Now, because Brahma has now three faces and everyone's forgetting the fourth, people begin to see Brahma as the three stages of the sun. Now remember, for the indigenous people, the sun always is seen as androgynous, which it is. It has two poles. It's a generator. It has to have two poles. It cannot be a man. So the heresy of the Catholic Church is to call the sun, S-O-N, the sun, S-U-N, and then make everyone believe it's a male, and then kill it. You see, the sun is an androgynous dynamo. So for the indigenous people, androgyn meant you had three components, not two. Because you had to have the mother, the father, the son. You had to have the rising, the noon, and the setting. Everything had to be done in threes on the third planet from the sun, on third dimension, not two. So this is where the language game starts to come in, because you start to see that what an androgynon is two parts. No, what an androgynon is three parts. Because there has, it has to have a creating component. So when it finally gets to humanity, it gets to humanity in symbols like what I'm posting here, which is titled Trisolar Sol Om On, which is Basically, you see the red feet, the red feet of Hermes there with the three stages of the sun. We have the sun in the morning with horns, and I'm just going to show you how they begin to deface the symbol. Then you have the middle of the noon, which is the only one that's balanced enough, and then you got the nighttime raven, black sun, and then sitting on great typhoon, the serpent. You see, so these images that will come forth trying to explain what Trimurti was were at some point by individuals who preferred it a lot more darker and a lot more dank in a nature. That's how they wanted the symbolism to be utilized. But what you're looking at here is the real sigil itself of what Solomon means. It means the three sons or the three stages of Brahma, but now the fourth stage, which is, of course, the mother or the door, is now removed. So let's continue. Now, you have Brahma here, and this is now, I'm gonna speed this up a little bit. Now you have Brahma, of course, in the tradition, and then you have his wife next to him, Saraswati. That's the next image that I'm uploading. But hold on, because a lot of the knowledge shows now that the character known as Abraham in the Bible was actually a Brahmin, or actually the teachings of Brahma. Because remember, Brahma is not a physical person. You see? What you're having to learn here is that the traditions now are being zoomorphized and encoded within statues. The ancient traditions have more to do with the ancient earth energies and how to manifest things in fertile fields using geometry projected from the mind. Not bringing these characters into physical reality as people and then actually saying they did what the energies do. But in a sense, because we do what the energies do, we are actually the manifestations of the power, and we can manifest power. You see what I mean? So anytime you see an image, you're never supposed to fall down and worship the image, because the image is of you. You're supposed to understand the image, and then that gives you a better understanding of you. So no, this, of course, is one of the keys to what gets corrupted later on. So what we have is Brahma and Saraswati is really Abraham and Sarah. So this means that in the beginning of the Bible, already the Bible, written by basically the Judaistic tradition, writing the Talmuds and the Midrash, Yad-Heh-Vah-Heh and the rest of the clique, they are putting together a book based on Eastern traditions. Not even their stuff. So that's the first flag. So what we have here is Abraham and Sarah come from the Eastern traditions. What you have to know now is that there was been a time where they had to leave the Indus Valley. Of course, if you notice, with the end of Angkor Wat, when they finally get to the bottom of why Angkor Wat was vacated and left, it was because the irrigation system completely collapsed. This is because of what the ancestors have been calling the deluge, which was actually in a small area, not over the entire world. But in an area, due to ice sheets falling, some also say due to the Surs and Ahuras fighting with Earth's energies, causing extreme imbalance in those areas. Some say that the expansion of the minds of the people began to pull the planets, the regions apart. The Earth crust, which good friend Santos Bonacci talks about, as the people begin to expand, the Earth crust begins to split apart. Definitely could see how that could happen, because now this knowledge is being used, the Ruach, or what they call the Ark, is now being used in a way to destroy each other. So there's big wars, big imbalance. Then there becomes a time where everything starts to just fall apart. They call it sinking of Atlantis. So now everyone had to split up. And this is now what creates much of the division. Because there's already factions that don't like each other, such as the Chinese and the Japanese, but basically know that they come from the same parent, with the same kind of hair. Then one goes in one direction and says, I'm going up this way, you go to the left, I'll go to the right, fine. I'm creating empire, dynasty, Naga. Another one goes all the way to Egypt, returns back to the original lands of Upper Egypt, sets up there, Ra. Another person goes way over there to Korea, brings in the nighttime Saturnalian of Sat. Sat means basically every manifestation in physical reality, brings knowledge of Sat under Aya, EA, and sets up Korea, the core of Aya. So you have the Naga splitting up, but they're still war, they're at war with each other now with the powers. As you see, Big Zeus, who's basically Deuce, the divided god, with the, I'll show you pictures later so we can keep this in order, but with the Dorje rod, or the Vajra rod in his hand, trying to smoke Typhoon, who's just another head of the serpent himself. So you see these beings, who are really your ancestors, going and warring with each other. So stop making this some extraterrestrial's fault and all of that. No, this is what our ancestors were doing with the universal energy. The Naga, the conch shell, the pineal, the pine cone. So now we have an opportunity to, because we have mastered this knowledge also, at least within our camp, we've mastered this knowledge also, we are up to bat now to see how we're going to, what we're going to do with it. And that's why I tell you, if you keep your heart open and you keep asking yourself, what more can I do for the people? You'll be all right. You won't have to really worry about anything. But when you, if you let it consume you and you let it talk to you, as it says in the Arabic prayer, Udubillahi minallah shaitan rajim, meaning protect me from the whispers of shaitan, meaning the power of manifestation in the physical world, protect me from when it speaks. And let me always be, it's a judge over it, not it as a judge over me. This was when the serpent was never used as something to fall down and worship, as they're doing with Jesus, worshiping the Nehushtan. In front of them, the serpent, the brazen serpent on the rod, it was used as a tool or a wand or a caudaceous staff of Hermes to cure, because it has electrical energy just like Dynamo Jack is showing you with the prana. It has the ability to completely line up a person's system and to make a cripple climb trees. It has the ability to rearrange DNA. It has the ability to do many things. So let's keep going. The next thing I'm going to show you here is just the Asuras pulling the Naga. So you can get, again, that the idea here is that the Naga is not a human being, in a sense. It's an energy. This is the last picture of me showing everyone that. Because everyone loves to jump on the side of energy and say, that's me. But remember, you'll make the same mistake as so many other people. So here in the temple, you see statues of the Asuras pulling the Naga in their direction towards their temple, so that they can consecrate the power that they're working with, so they could do more of what they're doing, which is going to war. Ang Bak is a really good movie to show you the wars between the Khmer empires and the Naga kings. So you see the energy being pulled, but you also, again, can understand that the energy itself is more or less passive. It's who it gets in the hands of, because of course the Asuras, who were later on just called the demons, and the Aryans, and you can see how they've glorified themselves because they're the ones that are writing those books, were at a in a conflict with one another. This became known as the caste system. Darker fighting the lighter. Here we go. Next picture here. I love these illustrations because it just really, like, because some people can hear this stuff and they be like, oh, I don't know. Well, it maybe means you didn't do your research, because look, it's all over the place. So what happens is now is that people start to click up. The same thing that we're doing right now. Because Brahma was split into three different deities, mainly Shiva, the Mahadeva, some people just said, you know what, I'm with Shiva. Shiva was only the masculine principle, because these warlike colonies began to debase the female, and basically strong warrior-like men began to gather in packs, and then because they didn't have really much to do with all that fire that they were carrying, because again, this is our fathers, then they would just go and pillage and rape things, already with the contamination of the mind of using the sword on another brother, this, or using the S word on another brother and sister. So I have here a Shiva devotee to show you how early it starts. This is actually a modern picture of a Shiva devotee in India at the age of 4 or 5. So what happens here also, if you want to understand, well, why are these people doing this? for many of them, and almost all of them, it's not even a choice. It's not even a choice. Now you have a choice. What has occurred? Something has already lifted a mighty burden off of you by giving you a moment to make a choice. It's like holding a door open for you for a moment. Look, man, make a choice now. Hurry up, man. I can't hold this thing for a long time. You see what I mean? That what's happened is like a window of opportunity for a lot of people, because before you were all, they already knew. Like they talked about in the Mayan text, when they cast you when you were born, and they knew who you were going to be. Even if you didn't want to be that, you were going to be made to be it. There goes a whole nother life becoming something someone else says you're supposed to be. You see what I mean? So let's wake up here. Let's go to another image. Because many people also are still in these kind of situations. They're like, man, mama was in church, daddy was in church. If I don't go to church, these folks kick me out the house. You see? So this situation is still going on. This is now, of course, the Britain rule. They just tell you what, you give you a language that's based on what you're supposed to believe, and then they give you a religion to tie into it, and then now they got you from both sides of division. That's how it works. Now we're shaking off the shackles. Now here it is, a picture I'm showing you, or coming out the pin. I break pins. That's what's really happening today. You break out the pin. So this is what I mean. This is a perfect image. I just came across this one while I was searching for images today. I said, that's it. It's capturing the entire thing. The patriotic warrior clan. Like, this became such an idolization with Ben Saba and the Assassin. You see the games being replayed today, Assassin's Creed. You see, there's a lot of remnants of the Crusades. Everyone wants to be a Knight of Malta, get knighted by the Queen because he ran the sword through nobody other than his brother. And you get that. And that, if you're watching it from the Keether or from space, is basically insane. To see a race actually consume itself and destroy itself, divide itself. But remember, that's what's going on in the Matrix. So now the religion for these men, and this is how God starts to become more than, or actually the terms God even come into play. And we'll talk about what God really means later on. But this is when the Most High starts to become divided, because now the Most High is divided amongst men. And this is why. Let's say I'm sitting over here as a Asura, and then my brother sitting over there as a Aryan, and he's praying to a God that he's given a specific name. Okay? Now, because he's supposed to be my enemy, I'm definitely not going to be praying to his God. So I need to come up with another name. So, of course, whatever was the most terrible, fearsome thing in our language, we would choose that. So now this name becomes the name of the God. And then when the warrior prays to the God, or worships, W-A-R, not W-O-R, but it's the same word, when they worship the God, now they say to God, God, help me defeat all my enemies and lay them waste. Okay? So, and then on the other side, there's the other one, God, and another name, Allah. Please allow me to, you see what I mean? Now they've taken the universal energy and divided it up amongst themselves and now are fighting each other with it, praying for the God to destroy. So, of course, one man is not going to like the other man's God. And this is how there ends up becoming so many gods. See how this is working? It's a game, man. They got you in this game. You got to really wake up or you'll be here forever. Like, trust me, this is an endless knot. You choose to wake up or you choose to remain asleep. Your choice. So now the patriotic religions have come in. So everyone's confused these days about who Satan really is. Satan is set. Set is the father of the Israelites and the Ishmaelites. Set is Seth. Seth is the only one that actually survived out of the whole Cain and Abel situation after Adam. Adam had also Seth there. And he's the only one. Cain wandered off to the land of Nod, meaning the underworld. Abel went the same place and was later on called Baal. However, Seth was the one ruling from the position of the underworld. So the next picture you see here is on the left, Set, fighting Apophis in the underworld. Set's got the Dorje in his hand. to show you that that is the symbol that they use for what you could do to weld the energy with, the real rod, as it later on became known as. By the way, this is, I think, 2 hour show today. So again, you see Apophis with the snake legs and the wings, is he a Naga? That's the same image of the Naga. So you can see now, whoever's using the painting, whoever painted the pictures, like the stingy kings, like they say Ramses defaced all of the statues and temples. He's the son of Ra, right? So they just say, hey, put my face on it. I just destroy everyone. I smoke everyone. And put that rod in the hand there. I don't even know how it used to work or what it does. And put that Ankh all on my face. And these are the same attitudes that we have now. There's nothing new under this sun, trust me. But the reality is that the manifestation of the power that's here and what you choose to do with it is what governs where you go, how you see, how many filters you have on your optics, meaning how many people have determined what it is that you should see before you see it. And the time lag. You got to get a lot faster to be caught up with those who are welding the power and the energy to manifest realities right before you think. And we're going to get into that, how the matrix is really constructed now, not how it was constructed before, because after finding out all the knowledge, many of the individuals decided that they just wanted to go ahead and change the entire system and started working with that, with new cabals or new cables and new languages. And this, again, is a special, so you'll get all that today. So just to let you understand that there are individuals that are here now. That's why I love to jump back and forth from the past to the future, because many people think, oh, this is ancient knowledge, but it's not what's going on right now. You're wrong. In the Kenpo masters, and also those of the Dojin sect, still carry the Dorje anytime they are doing any type of ceremony or ritual or prayer. And this picture is being uploaded now. It's taking a moment, or it's being published. But in this picture, you'll actually see the lamas there with the Dorje. Because remember, it's not the Dorje that has the power. It's the individual that has the power. And the Dorje, which was also fashioned during the Bronze Age, and that's why most of the, which is the Indus Valley Age, and that's why most of the images and statues are bronze. The Buddha statue is also bronze, because bronze is one of the only metals that can hold spiritual energy. That's why a statue of the Buddha contains all the energy of all those who have sat in front of it and meditated on it. So the same thing with the Dorje. The Lama is known to use the same Dorje. That Dorje is held like this. You remember that sign. So what happens is with that energy and with that bell, because when you start to nod out of this reality and you're walking in between planes, you have to bing sometimes to get the vibrations or to move things out of the way. These bells are also used to move other entities out of the way while they're going through frequencies. So you'll see that the high knowledge, which is where the adventure really is, not necessarily in PlayStation, is already being conducted by our elders. And in the Eastern traditions, of course, they're really tight-lipped about any of this kind of knowledge, because they're waiting for Brahma to reincarnate into the Western world, which he said he would do. That's the other teaching of the whole Brahmism. They said that in the end of the life of Brahma, or in the end of Brahma's meditation, Brahma decided to incarnate into the lowest plane and to bring it up from underneath. If you want to understand what they say is happening with the universal and the planetary energy, is the planetary energy decide that it will go into deep slumber to later on wake up to rise all of those that were in sleep and arouse them from sleep. And that's what's happening now. So, rise up from sleep. You see here, now, they're using the Dorje. And here's the whole idea, because we're basing now the human power on our condition today. We're basing the ancient human power on our condition today. After Smog, red number 5, pretty much at least 3 or 4 of the layers of our atmosphere missing, burning out the retinas of our eyes. Using our eyes as the indicator whether something exists or does not exist. So after all of this that we're doing now, of course it's hard for you to see a glimpse of what power and energy we used to have. Most people are asleep now. That's another thing about the Warrior Clan. Warrior Clan seldom sleep. So that's why they, most of the time, were keeping up so much ruckus and raiding at night. They had so much fire and energy inside of them. Here is an image of the, I just call it Aryan firemen, but actually what you're looking at here is the Holy Assembly between the great prophet, as they call him, and the one who let him know, and we'll just leave it at that. And that is actually a snake in the middle, but actually more of a lizard, by the way. But you see the fire coming from the head, in which means enlightenment, where the original terms and the original meanings of enlightenment came from. But that is about inside, enlightenment, not outlightenment. So enlightenment is when your chakras actually awake completely and line themselves up in the energy fully cycles. Now, of course, energy can bottleneck and cycle within a small area, making a person extremely demonic, especially if it's the lower areas. Likewise, the energy can get stuck in the higher areas, making someone appear to be loopy and crazy. So what happens is that these men, however, were already familiar with the energy. A turban is a turbine. It's the same word. It allows you, because your hair is the actual emanations and generation of the energy, which of course is the rite of the Nazarene to never cut their hair, and the rite of the sick or six to never cut their hair. Generations and dynamos were known to these people already. And that's why, thanks to a good friend that let me know this, Justin in Canada, who's also of that descent, said, yeah, Hitler even said, give me an army of sick and I can conquer the whole world. Because the knowledge of these individuals about their energy, the energy connection with the sun is a dynamo. For those who want to read into that later on, go ahead. Here we go. Now you see that everyone's kind of familiar with the energy. This is the time where everyone's familiar with the energy. So now there becomes a big change. In order for us to fast forward into the future and also get to the end of the program, then, or the show today, what you have is you have to understand also that in Egypt now, Moses, or Tutmosis, is on the throne, okay? Now, the Hittite kings even had Dravidian last names. So if you want to understand that, actually I have a link for that. Let me get that, source that link to everyone here in a moment. Just so you can understand that many of the Hittite kings had Dravidian names. Hittites with Tamil names. I'll source that link. And this gives you the connection on why everyone is aware of this power and energy and how it's not just exclusive to Moses, not just exclusive to the Egyptians, not just exclusive to the Chinese, etc., etc. But here you have Tutmosis, who's Moses, who's Akhenaten, who actually took the knowledge from Egypt and started going all over the world with it. So this is the time, and as you see that, of course, the first place to go was to Upper Egypt, which is actually Nubia. Thutmosis came through as Ra, which is the tradition of the ancient Egyptian system, got everyone excited through Rastafari, Menelik, Sheba, who's actually the queen of Sheba, is actually the queen of Shiva. A V and a B are actually the same. And the cult begins to spread again, and Ra is added again, basically, attempting to summon an army to go and defeat the same individuals that he lost to before, or he says his father lost to. Remember, all that keeps happening here is new people get the empire, they start reading the ancient Puranas, then they jump on one side, just like Shiramavarman did when he uncovered the ruins of Angkor, when he began to build the temple of Angkor Wat. So they jump on the side of the god, then start claiming that they're the god, or the ancestor, then read where the ancestor left off with their wars, and then start continuing the wars of their ancestors. Okay? So coming through, you see the snake on the head inside of the solar disk. This shows you that the snake is not the sun, because the sun is in the center of the snake. They're saying that the snake, again, is a symbol of earth, and is actually around the sun, which actually is a symbol of the beings or the souls that live here. We keep going, and this is your connection of where you get the ancient Ethiopian covenant, which is why the Ethiopians are still screaming that, hey, we had the covenant first before those people over there that are saying they're in Canaan and the Israelites, and that was their territory. That's not really what happened. We got usurped. That's our knowledge. But remember, everyone's knowledge is being taken. They took the knowledge of Saraswati and Brahma, and then the knowledge of the son Menelik coming and uniting Upper and Lower Egypt under Menes, and then took, you see, they're making like a religious hodgepodge and putting it all in one book. How clever. So if you can think about this, notice how, again, the ideas of the mother and the child, which come from Upper Egypt, have always been known there as even now the cult of the Black Madonna. But then Madonna, of course, gets a face change, and she even actually is doing Super Bowl performances now with Nicki Minaj. But what I'm saying here is that You can see who's carrying the ancient covenant. So this teaching does not belong to the people who are actually teaching it. So now, again, you're getting another eyesight of the actual corruption. This is where things begin to change. Something happened between in the marriage of Upper and Lower Egypt, and I believe that there was then a uniting of the line, the bloodlines of the black, what was then called the black or melanin dominant people, and then the melanin recessive people. And then there seemed to be ultimate betrayal from both sides. But how this begins to manifest is that they decide that they were going to start using the same religion. And this is also why you get individuals such as Menelik, but still carrying the same cross that the Queen of Sheba has on her, the Queen of England has on her neck, or on her her clothing. And let me get back to my notes here. That has to be saved really for an entirely more vast conversation about what exactly happened in the covenant, because the covenant was made by Salt, meaning that Salt is actually the symbol of the being Set and Saturn, because it's a cube. Salt forms itself in a cube. So the knowledge was given to these individuals that came out of Lower Egypt with Moses. See, I guess I'll have to get into it. Notice that Moses comes out of Egypt, but was born in the house of the Egyptians, was raised as the Egyptian child, and then leaves the Egyptian family and sides with the people who are basically the slaves. Okay. Now, the people in Egypt, the ones that were actually the slaves, were the captives of many other empires, including the Babylonians. Okay. Moses decides that he wants to have his own kingdom, and he wants to take the Ark of the Ruach, because he later on becomes the same being, Menelik, and he wants to start traveling over the rest of the world as if he's God. Okay, so now here's Moses with these people fleeing from basically the land to go and conquer other lands, because that's what was promised to him by the God that he worshiped, which said, I will make you conquer all lands until I rest you in the promised land. Okay, so that's why there's all this conflict, because you literally have one individual who thinks they're being sent by God going through other people's territory and killing everyone again in the name of God, just so you understand that. And the individuals that are with them, by the way, are not only Moabites, Hittites, Amalekites, Amorites, and every other ite that was in Egypt, basically in slavery. That's why Egypt was known as the Lower Egypt, the underworld, because you were going to die there if you got sent there. It was a prison. So what happened was is that we're taking that knowledge from there, and those people who were also there, which were many colors. That's why I said the Hebrews had 12 tribes, meaning that there was a whole group of Hebrews. Like, the Hebrews were actually a group of people who were gathered up from multiple tribes, some of them being kidnapped, basically, from their tribes. When these slavers, which you have to also realize, man is hunting man at this time. Now there are slaves. We're acting worse than animals at this time. So, if you want to understand again how it all connects, somehow, the people that Moses are also with, or Thutmoses, who's attempting to be a ruler by himself, but everyone can see the fallacy, the people that he's with decide to usurp him too. This is why Aaron is wearing the breastplate when Moses should have been wearing the breastplate, if that's supposed to be where the power from God came from. So it's showing you right there that there is an internal conflict within the tribe of Moses. And this was often manifested in the Old Testament, the Bible, where it says that certain ones of them were taken away because they did this and this with the, and then Dathan and them got into a fight. And they're showing you all the stories that there with these people, there were constant conflicts because they were all from different places, and everyone was just lamping to see if they could figure out the knowledge of the Ark so that they can become the rulers. That's why they say the Philistines even got the Ark and then broke out trying to mess with the Ark. They're just showing you. The Philistines end up getting the knowledge of how to turn on the dynamo energy of the body and end up basically manifesting their worst nightmare within themselves, which was leprosy. So now notice, this is what's this called the Sanhedrin, which is laid out in the number 72, 72 men. Of them, the highest is the Tanaim, meaning those who know what the angels do. No, actually, excuse me, the highest of them is Nazi, N-A-S-I. And if you have not been smart enough through etymology courses by now to understand that an S casts the shadow of a Z, meaning that when you, in this cabal, everything has a shadow. So to understand what words are at times is some words are shadows for other words, and that is the relationship between an S and a Z. So a Nazi is a Nazi. So if a Nazi is the highest member of the Sanhedrin, And the Sanhedrin is a Judaistic tradition. Why are the Jews complaining that the Nazis are the ones that actually sacrificed them when that is their quote-unquote highest member of their Judaistic tradition? Okay. So, like I said, there will be liars amongst you that will say anything to get your energy. You have to understand that there's people that it's a certain condition, and I read about this as the condition of a demon, but it manifests as the condition of certain people. It's where if you're sick, if they're sick, if they can get your energy any way they can, they will, if they can get you to feel sorry for them. They'll say, oh, my goodness, I'm sick, and then you're there taking care of them, and the inside they're like, I'm not even sick. Okay? Now, this is also a person who, you know, every time you come around, they have a problem. They like to complain to you. You won't believe what happened. And it's like they always wreak that energy on you, okay? Now, this is a vampire, okay? A psychic vampire. So psychic vampirism is what was really going on in Lower Egypt. Because remember, the Lower Egypt corresponds also to the Necromicon, the Book of Al-Hazred, or the Book of the Dead. But we'll get into that later on. And the Book of Coming Forth by Day, which is all this is necromancy. And this is because a lot of people, before Egypt became a prison house, would go to the Lower Egypt would go to Lower Egypt to find out where their dead ones or lost loved ones had been or had been going to. So let's go again. Now we have a situation, of course, where the Nazis start to use the swastika. Now, to understand everything that I've explained to you thus far is to understand that, obviously, that Hitler had a fascination with somehow connecting himself with the original people. Now, it's obviously from what I explained, it's obvious from what I explained to you that the Aryans were, which they actually depicted as blue, were a part of the group of the original people. Of course, the Asuras were too, okay? So, obviously, whatever was going on with the Asuras, Hitler didn't like. And that was because the Asuras were often written as demons because the books that were written were by the individuals who had been conquering Asuras. Because remember, they're continuing this caste system war. So, of course, Hitler jumps on the side of the bird rather than the snake at first. And then erects that as the flag, which is one black eagle, the nighttime version of Solomon, by the way. And then takes the swastika, which is the ancient Aryan symbol, and then starts to march all over the world saying he's continuing the Aryan wars. Okay? Next picture. Notice here, Sikhs were involved. My good friend Justin let me know, 30% of the British army was made up of Sikhs at one time. That seemed so odd because the Sikhs were only a small percentage of people, meaning that pretty much every male Sikh at one point in history was a member of the British Army. They chose those people for what they needed to carry out. Now here we go with the corruptions. Now that the knowledge is in the hands of one who is surely dominant in attempting to control the world, but has no respect not only for the divine feminine, but also even for anything as a respect of life that is supposed to grow. Their idea is to destroy the world and to make a new one. They don't want to deal with what we have now. How ungrateful. So what happens is that then you get the ancient knowledge and symbolism being taken to a different level. What I've sourced here is the image of what they call Yah. Yah just means fire, by the way. The fire obviously associated with Kundalini, but now it's been kidnapped by an individual who appears to be, I think, Caucasian here, with the shadow of himself using the interlacing triangles, but on both sides. Remember, one triangle is supposed to be masculine, the other one's supposed to be feminine. Now, actually, what you have here is the deity they know that's known as Deus. Deus is the dying god. That's why die means two, and you have to die, meaning you split from your spirit to body, and you're divided at that point. However, notice how they took this imagery and began to change what the meaning of it is once more, and then it became known as the god Yah, okay? You have to follow this because this is where the modern religion really is now. Yah and El, just to make sure I connect all this for everyone, now that they've come out of now that Hitler, and actually not just Hitler, but many of the individuals that are in that party, which are called Turians, they're from Tyre or Turks, have taken the knowledge and now made it in their image. Now all of the deities or the original mantras for the levels of energy become actually Santa Claus type figures. This is the Santa Claus, the beard, the new version of Sat, which is the white beard looking like Santa Claus. Okay, so what you have here is the ancient coin struck by Cain, who's supposed to be the king, which also is a Khan, as in Aga Khan and Genghis Khan, who is a Kohen, which actually means priest in Hebrew. So this is now the entry of the one who is now saying the symbolism belongs to me, I'm God. This is the entry of Yaldabaoth, okay? So what happens here is that now there is one who has the ancient knowledge and teachings that seeks to profit from it. So he's striking coins. This is also the connection with the Sanhedrin and those that are in the temple, because they began to be the governors of all life, all parts of life, banking, food, basically through money and striking coins. So what happens here is that now God is about money. And I'll show you later on how this metamorphosizes in mathematics, but it's basically that they've taken the reproduction symbol, which is the circle, they've made this, struck this coin, notice also a dollar is a rectangle, this is the rectangles, Temple of Solomon, Phi, etc. But they've taken the same geometry and then start striking coins with it, because still esoterically, inside of a person's mind, they associate these shapes and the symbols that are often used as fertility. And this is also why most dollar bills and things have symbols that the nation is very familiar with and stands behind. And so the national plant, national bird, etc., is always on the currency. This is to make a person feel like when they get the currency, oh my goodness, I like it so much. Oh my goodness, that's that bird, the abundant bird. Oh, that's that nice flower. Then they put faith in the money, just as they put faith in those real things as indigenous people, okay? So now you see also on this coin that Cain is using the L symbol, which is actually a right angle, which is actually used to as a tool to measure the stars even. It's an angle can be used in many different ways, especially the degrees of the angle. Also, of course, it's used in building and masonry. So you see L is given wings, even though they kind of look like raggedy wings, but obviously there's this idea to now make this individual God. Okay? Strike two. Now, I'm taking you through the metamorphosis, and as I said, this is really a compression of a lot of knowledge at one time, so we're doing our best just to make sure you get a clear expanse of what's going on in history. But, okay, this thing's taking a moment to load pictures, so we'll give it a moment. So now what you're seeing is you're seeing, again, the migration and the metamorphosis of the knowledge. Now you're seeing ultra-patriarch societies actually come in and begin to say, I'm God. And then they introduce this God as under the names of the indigenous vibrations for fire and power. Why? Okay, let's go to karate real quick. It'll be just like that snowflake or that water molecule I showed you. There's certain tones that give you power. So when you see a person going to break a brick, they generally go, yeah! And it's something about that yeah that they do in the end that allows it to break. And they say it's actually a focal point of their power. Now, if you understand the Holy Word, what the Holy Word is actually two convex triangles shaped in an hourglass for implosion, known as the Orion war cry, meaning that what the ancient word was supposed to do, especially by the one who knows how to speak it properly and can hold it, because remember, it's like Thor's hammer, only a god can use it without it having some adverse problem or it just not working at all. So what this was about is it's an implosion in itself. It's actually a buffer or a field or a shield itself. And not only beyond that, it actually is the name that does not come back void. It can create all things in a three-dimensional reality, just so you understand why when someone explains all of that to you and then you understand what it really means, and then they say, but that's this person. This is what we're talking about. And in your reality, what I just explained to you is now credited to certain individuals say, I'm the one that does that. I'm the one who did that. But in reality, this is, again, as we talked about in the beginning, the universal energy of Earth when the chakras are actually functioning and balanced properly within the individual that is attempting to weld the power. So what you have here now is an ancient Well, this is not so ancient, I wouldn't say, but it is definitely very old. But it shows you many of the coins and many of the talismans that were struck by the people of this time and their reverence for Yao, who they began to know as I-A-O, which is actually still used, or J-A-O, which is still used in China to this day. And there's even an equivalent to Adonai Yahweh in Chinese, because they later on, through being ransacked by the Turians, began to be under the same dominion, paying taxes with these coins. So as you see, the talismans carry certain symbols that you see being used in reality. And you can understand that every single symbol of power they wish to absorb. So they absorbed, as you see on the right side, the pentagram. They absorbed the Star of David. They absorbed the angle. They absorbed the turtle's back. They absorbed, in many cases, the Z. They absorbed the Resh symbol. So it's replete. The dog face god from Canaan. Dog is God. Backwards, as you can see, which is they worship truly the Lord of the underworld. Their God is at night. Their day begins at night. Their year, the beginning of their year, begins at night to them. They worship the nighttime. They're completely inverted. So they'll take symbols such as the pentagram and they'll turn it upside down to show you who they are. They'll take symbols such as the hexagram and they'll turn it where there's two points up to show you who they are. They can turn anything that was used to give life and energy 180 degrees and against, which means death, which is some what many people said that the original flag that the Nazis were using, it was never because of their idealism to hook up with the ancient Aryans, but more of their idea of turning it backwards and making it symbolize the cult of death, which later on, of course, moves into the symbol of the cult of death and skull and bones and crosses and the rest of what they had inherited from some of the indigenous people that were actually in the United States. Why every indigenous person is attempting to pretend like they weren't worshiping the cult of death under the symbol of the owl already. And that should be known. Now, let's keep going. So you see here, two-faced Janus. Now God has lost the God, or the Most High has lost a try. Or the tribe principle, and now been debased to two-faced dog god Janus, which is where we get our word January from, which is the dual god that says the constant contradictions that you find in the Bible. Let me show you some contradictions of the dual god. Of course, the dual god says, I do both good and evil, but nothing good can come forth from those who do evil. Dual. The dual god says, let there be light, but obviously it's not light itself, because if you are already light, why would you need to create it? The dual god says, I am not the father of confusion, but two books later says, let us go down and confuse them. The dual god says, cursed is anyone who hangeth upon a tree, but later on within the same book, a man is hung on a tree and everyone worships him. The dual god says so many things that are dual, it serves to put the person who's reading the literature of dual gods, known as Dios, which means two, Deus. These are the rites of Bacchus. This is Baal. These are all the rites of the dual god, where the devil is another entity that plays around the religion. So then you have all these individuals who actually idolize the devil. This is what this creates, when the devil is made external. Remember, in the totality, everyone is all from the same existence and creation, all coming out of the same womb. If you see it in division, then it actually gets the best of you. If you make an external devil, and then you concentrate it with energy and belief, then it can indeed walk around. So you understand what a thought form is of what the real original power that we have through creation, through thought, which is far more powerful than words. So most people are looking for the word of power, but what is a thought of power? So the thought of power is also called a eidolon, the idea of it. So when you talking about the actual powers that are running around now and why nobody can see them, because they're thought forms. Now, again, that yearning for the primordial is getting humanity into this darkness all the time. And that's why it's important to light resplendent inside, to shine that light full spectrum, not just white. White is not light. By the way, white and black cancel each other out. They're the absence of color. Be full spectrum is what we're talking about. So now the dual god is introduced. This is, of course, the papacy. Papacy is pa. Pa makes paper. Paper comes from papus. Papus means a person who makes paper. They cut roots, which is trees. They know how to do pacts and oaths and rituals and bindings through draconian law, so that way that you become binded when you put your signature and make that and pledge that oath, and you don't even understand what you're even doing. This is the trickery, okay, of the dual god, who actually treats its children or its citizens or whatever it wants to call it as if they're enemies and commodities. This is what has to change by this world. And this is why, until religion is addressed, none of it will change. You can have thousands of people sitting around a circle talking about different changes they're going to make with trading embargoes and all this stuff, and it will do nothing, because the religions is the seat of the entire confusion in itself. As long as there are separate religions, then there will never be a full understanding of who the totality really is, which is the person. That's the whole secret to this world. All is self. There's nothing outside except for what you unpack and bring here. You can unpack something and say, here's a remote control. I built it. Here's an iPhone. I built it. And where is it coming from? Your mind. Your mind is tapped into another field where those ideas come from. When you bring them into 3D, it may be their first time here, but not the first time the universe has heard of it. So get it right. So there are individuals who know how to go into astral planes, pull ideas out from other timelines, and then bring them here, and then act like it's so new. A real time machine. Whatever song they like in Quasar 5, I'm sure they'll like on Earth later on. You see? Stop getting played. 33 steps in the spine. This means the spine is actually broken half and actually laid out in levels of masculine and feminine energies in order to keep you animate, the animus, right? So the reason why there's three and three is because one triangle, the other triangle, masculine and feminine. So let me show you how they want to show that to you. This is an important thing to really witness, with how our knowledge is being corrupted. And this corruption of the knowledge will allow a person to be here forever if they don't get it right. And this is why it's got to be stopped. It must be rectified, the truth. Remember, stand behind truth, and you don't have to worry about any enemies, because the truth will survive everything. So surely you will survive. Now notice this. This is in one of those temples out by the Vatican, and they're showing you the magical square of the number 33. What a magic square is, of course, is whether you add the number left or right or up and down, it all equals the same number. So this is the magic square for the number 33. Now, what you see is, because 33 is a symbol of uniting the masculine principle with the feminine principle, their idea is what you see on the left, or excuse me, on the right, which is a man embracing another man in a kiss, which they call the holy kiss. But you can clearly tell here is very homosexual, because they attempt to invert the knowledge. So what I'm saying is that not the homosexual in the traditional sense of what's going on in reality through chemical imbalance, but homosexual in the sense of one that is of one particular sexual gender desiring the same gender, which just means desiring the same thing that you already are. So you can move beyond that, is what I'm trying to explain to individuals who are still trying to understand that in their mind. That if you prefer the same thing that you are, that is ultimate narcissism. Now you're fully ready to move back into what you've always been doing. The reality here is to expand. Earth is about expansion. The universe is about expansion. It keeps going beyond this. So even when you get beyond those psychological natures, the lascivious natures, you still have stuff to do. So the best thing for us to figure out is what is most important for us to be doing. Let me keep continuing this here. Now, again, by the end of this conversation, you'll also know about the complete language of power, for those who want to know so bad, and how it metamorphosized. Once again, I'll show you, it's very important for you to understand that crystals are the magnetic buffers for the chakra centers, because they're actually the pure correspondence to the chakra centers themselves. And that's why that each crystal is related to a certain planet. Now, when this knowledge gets into Judaism, of course, it gets as the breast of Aaron, also called the marble die, which is basically meaning the marble god, meaning the god of stone. Okay, so the god of stone has 12 stones that correspond to 12 tribes, and then those 12 stones are supposed to be used to balance out the 12 chakras, and then when one is in possession of the name, which is inside of themselves, then the chakra wills begin to balance themselves. This is the buffering system that is necessary before one would ever attempt to unlock Kundalini. Because remember, Kundalini is a coiling up of all your past experiences along with your ancestors. So if you don't have everything lined up properly, it has the effect of basically releasing a coil, and there's a ceiling right there. So the coil would go up and then hit that ceiling, and it'll actually, or hit that chakra that's blocked, it'll damage that chakra, causing some type of disease or deformity, and then it'll go back down into its original area again. So remember, chakras have to be buffered and lined up before they're open. And of course, chakra blockages have a lot to do with things that have happened to us as children, things that what happens when, with what we're eating, and also things that happen with what we're thinking. But again, that's another course. Okay. All right, let's spice it up a little bit here. I may take a little break and then and finish this. I'm going to take a break and then come back and explain to everyone the mathematical correspondence to this so that you understand the new language of power that's being used in the dimension. And but I at least would like to schedule a break here since we did the two-hour show. Now, here's another thing I'm going to show you. Again, taking the symbols. Now, what you see here is called the quadruple resh, which was basically Hebrew, then the symbol resh, taken and made four times into the symbol of the swastika. And this is a reach, even though that these correspondences definitely have a meaning, especially in Kabbalah, but this is a reach to take the ancient symbol of the swastika and try to make it mean something specific to what these people are calling their language. So this is, again, branding what nature has done. You see what I mean? Like, that's all that you're seeing here on Earth, is that what nature has done and the expansion of what we've really gone into and what we know, they make all the new children and everyone forget, and then they brandish it in front of you as if it's theirs. Oh, we created the light bulb. When the Egyptians had the light bulb in the pyramids, it was too dark in there, so you need light bulbs. You can use L's, like arc waves, arc electricity. Like, these people had all, that's what the Ruach was. They already had an external generator of power. Large generators, sometimes the pyramids were. Is that yoga there? Or Yoda? Of course, Yoda is yoga. But anyway, and of course, I do have some really good yoga courses that don't involve the ritual. And those yoga courses are very important. They're basic one-on-one stuff that you can do, but then you'll see where your strength really is. And it allows you to really line up those energies for those who want to know about what is the brute force way of actually lining up the energies that are in your body that seem to not, that are blocked, that you can't seem to move with your mind. Meaning that when you want to forgive someone and forget, then it just, you just can't do it because the situation is too crazy for you, according to what your mind is saying. It's really willing to keep you here forever because it can't forgive that person, so it's holding them like an anchor. So what you have to do is you have to move it out. On the mat, get into the yoga, open up those centers and areas and make them stretch out, and then they'll pass that energy and let it go. So here's another thing with the Shriners. They're trying so hard. Like, here's another picture I've uploaded called the Shriners. You'll see it now. I mean, this is what I'm talking about. Like, now they've taken all the Eastern traditions. They've taken the crescent moon. Five crescent moons, of course, is a symbol of Shiva. They've taken the crescent moon because it has the points and the horns. This, of course, is the horn or the actual phallus principle. Bi bull is the word, meaning two bulls. Two bull Cain is also the name of the god of the Bible. So you see that they sacrifice the bull as a holy offering to God, who's just basically a bunch of BS. So what happens here is that they take the symbolism, play around in the decorations and the symbols and things like it's really going to do something for them when it's not. And this is what they talked about, of course, in the scriptures, of where those who put on the vestments and the priestly robes and all these different things, and they imagine it's going to do something for them. They put on the crystals, put the Hoshin on, and then they put the phylactery on, and then the triple shin or the quadruple shin on the forehead, and then every single thing that you would need to power up the vehicle, but no key. No key. Because you cannot do this to yourself. That's what their big lesson is that all of what they're doing in the world, the grand creator is going to show them you can't do this to yourself. And then whoever elects to get involved with them and choose different sides, it's going to show the same thing. So I already seen it. I was like, man,
tired of getting worked. Game peep game. Meaning that, man, after a while, you start seeing if you're a really, really rational person with life and you're really directly tapped in, you'll see the whole game. You'll be like, man, I'm not going to be played. Like, I just rather not. Sign me out. Like, the basketball field is configured as a phi-based racial. The football fields are the same way. You got 11 versus 11 players. Everyone's seeing 11-11 on their clock. The soccer ball is a pentagon and a hexagon intertwined. Man starts kicking around a ball as if that's the kicking around the world, wasting time, kicking the world into a net, shooting his ball into a net so that it can be trapped. You see? Like, I got time to play around with you guys. Like grown men. That's what they always say. Oh, I'm a man. I'm grown. Blah, blah, blah. Man, you don't know what that's about. I'm trying to teach these days what it's about, what I had to learn. Now, here's where the big play comes in. And I think that this is where I'm going to take a break because I need to get just a little bit of water in my system, a little bit of energy. And I want to come into this really, really... I'm going to come into this because this right here is the key to the matrix. And once you have this, then anyone not talking superior knowledge about truth is going to seem really silly. And then all of a sudden, you're just going to say, hey, man, why don't you go check out this website real quick and this one link right here, and it will show you what's really going on. So before we start that, though, I'm going to take a little break. I want to say wholeness and balance vibration to everyone. We got 97 people watching. Thank you for being here and allowing this all to take place. I mean, there wouldn't be for me a better place to actually celebrate my birthday if I was into celebration. But to me, every day is a birthday. I don't even like people calling me only on one time and saying, oh, hey, happy birthday. But, you know, I do accept it. But I call people every day, man, and say happy life. Like, it's a wonderful idea now for us to go into what we have in store for us and what we've already worked for, rather than thinking that we're somehow going to be shorthanded and shortchanged again. So I'm going to be right forward, as I always say.
All right, well, this is the masterpiece. This is the finishing move, as they call it. But like I said, I really wanted today to be like the breakthrough for everyone. And I wanted it to also be like the opening of a new page for all of us and the kind of closing on a very amazing book, and now we have to write our own. And that's another thing I want to say. I'm going to be spending a lot more time, especially within the next 2 months, getting the next book out. And so I may not be involved with the platform. I'm trying to keep the shows still going at least 2 or 3 times a week with just really impacting studies like the one we're doing today. But do know, if you know you don't see me around much, of course you can always drop me an email if you have a question. I can always answer in my email box. But just so you know, I'm going to be wanting to get this book together. Also, I'm going to do a sound test here. Let me see.
Just really impactful.
Okay, looks like everything is working properly. All right. Okay, let's begin this by first saying, like, notice how the most simplest things in our world could easily have the greatest level of power and energy if it's shaped and fashioned the right way. And to me, the biggest example of that is these tuning forks. Because if you notice, that's a lot of sound frequency and energy that's conducted by 2 very small devices, okay? So if you're ever wondering why there's mystical things in our planet and why it's so magical, it's to understand that this is just this. Imagine what you are. And how many different vowels and different frequencies and things that you have. So to tell you the truth also, the symbol of the heart, as you'll see in the symbolism of the chakras, is known as to be the hexagram. That it contains the 2 energies that are necessary to keep the heart pumping in and out and in and out and in and out. And this, of course, is like red and blue, fire and water. And so you can see really with your heart that it is a generator and a dynamo within itself. So we'll just use that as a symbolism for right now, because what I'm going to talk to you about is I'm going to talk to you about the broken heart. There is a part in the Bible that God, of course, says that he's not the author of confusion, but there's a scripture that says, let us
meaning that there is one being in a league of other beings, go down and confuse them. And if you look at that very clearly, then anyone who has a real heart and really cares about anything will put the Bible down from that point as if it's something to really consider as what you will want to be like. Because if you don't, if you say you're not the author of confusion, but yet you go cause the greatest confusion ever, something's seriously wrong with you, and it needs to be fixed. So this, when something is in a childlike phase, which is what the entities, many of the entities are always depicted as children, if you notice, especially in the Catholic, the whole Catholic pantheism and how they draw it, they always depict the children, because these children are indeed childish. So, or actually Chaldean is the term, if you want to understand the etymology. So the child has the broken heart, and this is what must be mended, because I'm not highlighting any of these individuals, such as the Archons or all these individuals, to go and get into another race or hate war with another part of themselves that has not been instructed properly. But the real level in the system of a cult reveals within itself what it's all about. It's just about how many individuals are like me who understand it fully and understand it and are actually going to go and tell other individuals. And then also being able to tell in a way those individuals comprehend it. And then also not encouraging an individual to just go headlong and choose one side of it, but to emancipate yourself entirely from it as a major lesson that your ancestors already learned. So what you have here is you have the language of Hebrew, which I explained to everyone before that it was phenomenal information. And when I discovered that Hebrew as a language was actually the hexagram or the shurikan, Star of David is what people call it, the hexagram, dropped on itself. So if you take all of Hebrew, just like this chart shows you, and you drop it on itself, then what you get is you get the Star of David, that they call it. But it's really the Star of the Dravidian. All you have to do is remove the R and Dravid becomes David. That's it. So that's also how easy it is to tamper with humanity, because you can remove one word, like instead of Nazi, Nazi, N-A-Z-I, it's N-A-S-I, and then the person thinks it's something different. N-A-S-A, then it's something different. But when you're talking about a language that has no vowels, it's just N-S. And if you understand what N-S means, then you understand the individuals who are attempting to embody that energy, okay? So what happens is the broken heart is the broken generator. And when the confusion of tongues took place, then the ancient and holy languages, or mainly the one that we were using, was broken apart. And different individuals took different pieces their way. That's how it manifested in the languages. That each language system of this world contains only pieces of the original language and are derivations of the original language. So what the original language is, because it, obviously the symbol of fire and water, is actually energy within itself. And this became birthed as known as the words of power. I'll tell you something about the words of power. You cannot speak any word of power in an infertile field and expect it to do anything. So people say, what am I talking about? See, the ancient people were fascinated with reproduction and fascinated with multiplication and fascinated with addition and prosperity. They took every single seed that they could find and they planted it. And they keep allowing abundance to come forth and they celebrated it. So anytime they spoke something that they wanted, it already had an ethereal component right then, waiting to be birthed into three dimension, because they were living in fertile fields. They didn't need to reconfigure everything to make it fertile and tap ley lines and put needles and Cleopatra's needles in Earth's meridians to channel energies into stadiums and suck all people energy and divert it into cubes and all of that. They didn't need to do all of that. You see what I mean? So now what you get a chance to see is the real code. Because at 34, I actually cracked the complete code to this matrix. And why people think that this is an illusion or a hologram-based reality. I'll tell you, how real you are determines how real the reality is. So, as you see here on the chart, when the Hebrew is broken up, it creates different words. So anyone who knows how to operate these words know how to operate energy. If you don't speak the complete language, you're missing parts, so the energy center doesn't work. This means you'll actually be off balance, preferring either left hand or right hand. So what this will look like in a field of interlacing triangles, also called Merkabas, is this Merkaba will be spinning everywhere. It doesn't mean that it wouldn't be spinning like a free radical. Some people say, well, free radical sounds like something I want to be. But everyone knows free radicals are bad for you. They just pop around everywhere. They have no order and no form. So this is what we're talking about with the out of balance Merkaba, is that even though it may look like it has a lot of energy, that's why you can see singers and stars and actors just act like they just have touched God or something. It has nothing to, that they're free radicals. They're just anything they hit, they're subject to destroy. You see Lil Wayne, he's now involved with skateboarding. All those young kids that are involved in skateboarding turn on one of Lil Wayne's old songs and the new ones and get introduced to death. That's it. So that's why, you know, in a sense, there was like this battle that was going on, but it was taking place in the mind, and it was going on with spirits. Man is the one who jumped in that battle with his weak flesh, meaning that flesh can't stand up against spirits. This is also what's happening in our reality. The individuals who are utilizing the knowledge have a spiritual understanding of what this knowledge is about, this code that I'm going to explain to you. And it's so important for you to see those tools and how they're used. It actually means they're keys in and out of this reality. Now let me show you. Again, this knowledge information is something of a seed. It begins to unravel as you begin to use your own creativity to understand the ramifications of it. So if the symbol of the Star of David, or the symbol of the Star of Dravid, or the Dravidians, is actually the symbol of a generator, when it's broken up, this means that a generator is broken up. Now remember, they also said that with this Hebrew language, that the knowledge of the computer is in the Hebrew language. You can go and Google this, and you'll find out that they say the actual knowledge of how to build a computer is encoded within the Hebrew language. So this means that this symbol also is so all-encompassing, it even encompasses the development of artificial organism, which is what a computer is. Okay? Now, I'm showing you a picture here, and I just have it titled The New Language. New language of power, because now a person can go and say the Egyptian words, and they're all out there, and nothing's happening. Why? It's infertile electric field. It's actually artificial now in most cities. The structures and the framework and the metal and the way it's welded in the right angles, that's a death field. So none of those words work, but there are ones that do. Notice how society's been switched over to math. Math is the new language. Why? When you see a number, you think it, this is the one that's not initiated, as just a number, 1, 2, 3, used to count things, 1, 2, 3. Then why is it not sticks then? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And some people say, oh, it's because we didn't want to draw out all those sticks, so we made symbols for it. Okay, is that what they told you? Is that what those Pythagoreans told you, who count really well by 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40? You see how you can do that very fast? You think because those numbers are even, you can do it very fast. But that's not the reason. It's because you've been trained that way, to think and count that way very fast. So any way you're trained to count, you can do very fast. But what if I told you that the letters, the numbers are actually the letters of a hidden language? A hidden language that was developed in order to figure out exactly how to feed a computer with the integers of how we react. It's 12 o'clock. So the first thing that, of course, had to happen is that we had to be made to react a certain kind of way every time, a 0 or 1. Either you do or you don't. There's a cause and effect. So you're in a world where, according to your next decision, is going to determine where you go next. Everyone's familiar with that. It's called a binary world. So with the number system, what you have going on is the ancient language. Now look at the ancient symbol for divide. Okay? Divide, you see two dots with a line in between. Now, if you study occultism, each circle is a symbol of a soul or a conscious living being. So you got a conscious living being on one side and a conscious living being on the other with a wall in between them. This means that they don't know that each other exists, so they actually are divided. This is what they have done with you and your spirit body, by the way. That when you go to sleep, that what you see running around is your spirit body, but you're so divided from it, you can't control it, make it do things, or anything. It doesn't. You act like it acts like it doesn't even know you're watching. Okay? Now, notice how right away you can start seeing, is it possible that math, because it has these weird symbols and squiggly lines and quotients, could actually be saying something beyond what we may think? So, in thinking about this, I went to Wikipedia, and I said, well, let me see what all the mathematical symbols are anyway. Because I can remember, I don't want to go and look at any of those numbers that they be writing on the board with physics and stuff like that. And that's definitely not the way to understand things. Like, I don't even understand what those folks are talking about. It's because it's a hidden language. Even the people writing it probably don't even understand what it really means. Today, they will. Notice this. This is the math divisor symbol. If you go to Wikipedia and you look up symbols of math, you'll find here, and you may will have to enlarge that, the divisor symbol, which is a straight line and a curve going right through, a little slash, okay? A little slash. And that means divisor. And we know a divisor is a person who divides, okay? So who else on the dimension is using this symbol? And let me show you. This is known as a Byzantine cross. It's actually a fairly popular version of the cross. And what you witness is the exact same divisor on the bottom. Because the individuals who are utilizing these religions to control people are also very familiar with math because they created math and they love numbers. And they're so insensitive because we talked about what the numbers do for you. They make you numb. That's why the word is numbers. And it starts to make you feel like everyone is just a number. As the populations get too high, and then the person attempting to do God's job starts to name everyone a number, and then starts to become extremely insensitive because everyone is basically a number. Social Security number, ID number. I think someone's asking how much time is left. You probably got about 15 minutes left. So what you see here is the Byzantine cross, and it has that symbol as a divisor. Okay? Now let me source another image here. And I'm going to tell you why. Now, since the ancient language is in this infertile field, when it's spoken, it doesn't do anything. But this artificial language, which is not real, based on the numbers, which mainly has a zero in it, which is not real, when using this system, it becomes the new system of power in the illusion. It's actually a way to maneuver the illusion. And this is why anyone who knows numbers very well and knows math very well, generally does pretty well in this society now. It has become their power. They know how to do the septadecimal and calculate it on the stock market. You have the cross symbol as the transpose symbol. Transpose means the same thing we talked about yesterday about the bath to completely change someone from what they were before. Transposing is the same thing, almost of a vampiric nature of shrouding a person with another shell. Of another reality or personality that they're stuck into. If you really want to understand what's going on, that symbol is a symbol of an unbalanced cross or a T symbol. Okay? And that's why you always see them carrying these everywhere. Let's keep going here. And again, I'm only loosely explaining what's here, because people really have to absorb this on their own and start thinking of the ramifications. Because what you'll get into understanding is that it's highly possible that if you could take a reality and you can start switching it into numbers, and then the reality begins to understand all the numbers that are involved with the responses, then a reality can be completely generated based on your next thought. Meaning that a reality could appear right before you thought you thinked it. That's the matrix. That's why the rules of the matrix can be bent and be broken. Here's another symbol. This is, actually, that symbol may have gotten sourced a little bit lower. Let's see if I can upload another one. And we are entering the end of the program. And what I'm trying to explain to people here pretty much is that now, in the mathematical symbols, you will find the occult symbols. Because when you break apart the Hebrew language, actually that did get sourced. If you see here, it says math symbols too. You actually find the Hebrew symbol Aleph and Beth in mathematical symbolism. Again, you find here another symbol. And so it's also interesting because what the symbols you thought you wouldn't understand if you started understanding math because you didn't like math, you understand a little bit of the occult knowledge. You go back to those mathematical and symbols of physics, and then you look at their explanations, and they equal exactly what they equal as a spiritual component. So that means that math is more or less a plagiarization of the spiritual world, that math itself is an artificial language used to feed computers. And when getting the computer to understand all of our moves through numbers, then a computer can indeed start running the world, giving people, playing people basically like chess, understanding the next response to what they're going to do. And that's why it's important for you to begin to move in mysterious ways, which is actually just understanding the mysticism behind our entire reality and not taking it for granted, to not be like an individual that is more like a drone or something walking around the reality. So I'm having just a little bit of situation here with my my uploading system. So I guess we're going to go ahead and close out here. But I really wanted to tell everyone that, man, it's been an awesome, awesome adventure. Of course, things are going to get much more expansive here. It's definitely in our favor now to understand and understand everything that we know, and now to put that into action. And that's why I said there's going to be now a real writing of a book and a guideline and a website and even a movie, which is something that I'm working on now, that's going to really let you see this and let other people see this from another dynamic. Again, I have Math Symbols 3 that I did get a chance to just upload. And it looks like, the picture here is of an asterisk, which is named after Astara, or which is, of course, the five-pointed star, also known as the Asherah. Yahweh had his Asherah, or his reproductive tool. And this, because you'll actually see these two empires are underneath the hexagram and the Pentagon, as far as how they've separated themselves. And then you see here in mathematics that the asterisk, which is, or the five-pointed star, means convolution, but also multiplication. Now, convolution, of course, is very similar to chaos and confusion. Multiplication is also similar to the same thing, just about, meaning that a person graduates to a level that before they're prepared for it, they start to reproduce faster than they understand even what to do with what they've already created. You see, so there's this heavy level, especially with the pentagram and how it's used for power in creating things so abundantly, and there becoming a problem with the responsibility of the things that have been created. But still see that in mathematics, it says the same thing is what the pentagram does in spirituality. Again, brand new really insight in the whole thing, because most people have never, I've never seen anyone look at this. And I started having notions of this about a year ago, but wasn't really able to connect it. And again, all these symbols are parts of the hexagram pulled apart. So that's why math has so much to do with addition and multiplication, division. If you can learn that language or understand how that language works, then you actually have already tapped into an artificial version of how real organic matrices work. And this is why they idolize the numbers and the math now, especially a 5, which is still their unknown number or endless number. So you can still see that there's a limitation to their system of trying to tag everything with a number because there's things outside of the system. So they would love to keep you inside the system, behaving with the same numbers in the Enneagram, with the 6 hours of the 6 system, which is 6 plus 6 is 12, 6 times 12 is 24, 24 hours in the day. 6 is sex, by the way. This is how, when they've taken this knowledge of the hexagram and bought it into the Western traditions, it was bought for an external way, which became, instead of an internal union, an external union, or a basically sex. And this, when it starts to become used improperly, as you see, any of the powers within the inside of the kundalini or externally within reproduction, if it's used improperly, then you end up with excesses of energies and energies that are unbalanced. So see how it also connects. I'm going to finish these images off here. There's 4 more images here. Now, also, the set symbolism is in math. This was one of the craziest things that I came across, because, of course, the entity set does carry the trident or the dorje, which is half of the power or the red side of the triangle, with it all the time. This, of course, is what the fleur-de-lis means in hidden terminology. But notice how the set symbol, which you can see at the top, is the trident. And you can see this is called not only set symbolism, set membership in math, by the way. It's like set membership, superset, and subset. Meaning, and then the symbols used are the exact Chaldean symbols that were given for the hierarchy of the kingdom of Set. That's what I'm saying. Like, there are individuals in the reality doing things that, you know, are still far beyond what people can conceive is going on. And as long as that continues, then there continues to be this, you know, this debasing of humanity. And we're almost done here. To show you what it ends up in conclusion is symbols such as this, where now you have what is the image of the Vatican. They took the lion now. They've taken the dorje. They've taken the fish. They've taken the hexagram, they've taken the crescent moon, they've taken the rays, they've taken the throne, they've taken just about everything and said, this belongs to me, this is me, and that's y'all the Baal. That's what people didn't realize. Like, the entity that they kept explaining to people, especially in the Bibles and all these things, that will become a problem to man was actually, and woman, was actually themselves. And that when we went unchecked, when we got to the point where we failed to understand what the Most High was really saying, then we would have a situation. Now that situation is upon us. And as they always say, knowing is half of the battle in itself. And so now you know. Now you know that the math-based system is the one that they're using. You know that the symbols are connected to occult levels of knowledge. You know that generally the explanation behind the symbolism is what it does spiritually, but in a matrix. You know that a computer can be fed numbers and can actually hypothesize or basically predict what is going to happen next based upon the number if everyone is tagged with a number that corresponds to an actual essence of who they are. But the only way that these essences can be bolted onto an individual is they get you stuck in one of these stars, or one of these enneagrams, or one of these pentagrams, or one of these hexagrams, or any of these particular building blocks of realities. So what I'm encouraging you to do today is to stop being a block, to actually expand yourself fully into what you are, which is basically globulous. There's no hard edges except for what you choose to make when you choose to project yourself as a full spectrum light. So I just wanted to say again, wholeness and balanced vibration to everyone. And thank you for definitely tuning in today. And I will be with you. You'll definitely hear some notifications from me about when we're going to be going forward with some more of our shows. Let me check one moment here and see what this untitled image was that was in here. Actually, some more mathematical wonder. Which is, how could I forget? The upside down T. When they show the upside down T in mathematics, it means independent, the bottom element. This means, basically, in inverting their symbolism, to them, it means the person who is non-conforming. It means the person who does not fit into their equations. So, again, it's so important for us to see what's happening, to wake to it, to allow our children to know, to tell it on the rooftops, get people awake, actually get them back into themselves and to experience who they are, wake them up from their sleep, as I say. And so that's what I'm here to do for people and also to teach to people. Thank you for tuning in.